Hear these words by Claudio Carvalhas.
Come. Come into this place where God listens, where you need no money, no status, no fine clothes. Come as you are, broken, whole, sick, well, satisfied, or with deep needs. Come to sing, come to cry, come to hear, come to see, come and be ready, or come to be made ready. We are here. God is too. Good morning. Welcome to First Congregational Church of Natick. I'm Reverend Cindy Worthington Berry, and no matter who you are or where you are on the journey, you are welcome here. Whether you are with us in person or online, live or later, we are so glad to be connected. For more information about life at FCC Natick, please visit our website where you can sign up for the link and get lots of information about things happening in the congregation as well as the broader community. And if you are with us for the first time today, welcome. We are an open and affirming congregation, fully welcoming people of all sexual orientations, gender identities, and gender expressions. Children of all ages are welcome in this community in whatever way is meaningful for you. We have lovingly staffed nursery care, the playground down front, and Sunday school after the word for all ages. A few announcements today. This is the second Sunday in Lent, and our Lenten journey on the way to Shalom continues. You can still join in on the Soul Sabbatical gatherings on Tuesday evenings and Sundays before worship. And worship will also draw us into deeper reflection. For those in person, there are prayer stations around the sanctuary for you to visit, pocket prayer shawls with charms to add, and now orange strips to add to the prayer trees. For folks participating at home, we'd be glad to send you a pocket prayer shawl as well and add your prayers to the trees. Just reach out to me directly or to the church office. And today we've had art added to the sanctuary, beautiful work by Carolyn Williams up on the dais. There will be more info about it in next week's bulletin, but we want to remind you to experience it both from a distance and for those in person close up. So feel free to visit the art after worship or on other Sundays before. We have a piano concert happening in the sanctuary today from 4 to 6. This is Keys for Hoops, supporting Natick High girls basketball. The organizers of this event want you to know that ticket prices are a suggested donation. They invite you to give what you can in order to enjoy wonderful music and support the team. This is our first sort of public event in the sanctuary, so we're so glad to welcome these folks this afternoon. For those of you who live in Natick, we have important local elections coming up a month from now. There are lots of good opportunities to learn about candidates, including Coffee with a Purpose, which meets on Monday mornings, and one of the coordinators, Doug, will give us the scoop.
The scoop makes me think of ice cream. Can we just switch the subject?
Yes.
Trivia question, how many elections are there in Natick this year? How many times are we going to be going to the voting?
Four,
very good, four.
No, I said three, I was wrong, Jeanette was right.
Right. So, yeah, we have the presidential primaries, early March. We have the local elections, which is what I want to talk about at the end of March. And then we have the state primaries, and then the big one, the presidential election in November. So for the local election, Coffee with a Purpose is a Monday morning discussion group. Sarah and I have been involved in it a number of years. We have speakers of all kinds of different topics come and have very interesting sessions with us. But each spring, we try to devote sessions to any local election races, where, particularly where the seats are contested. And this year, for school committee, we have four candidates running for two seats. For three of the four Mondays in March, we'll be having each of three of those four candidates. Unfortunately, we weren't able to get the fourth one, but at least for three of the four, they will each be coming to one of our sessions, and we're going to have just a very relaxed question and answer and forum with them. It's very different than a lot of other candidate forums that you might have heard about or attended. It's none of this, so you have 90 seconds to answer and make sure you get in and dig at your candidates. It's a very relaxed, open conversation. People have time for extended answers and discussion about a number of issues. And schools, as we know, are super important. Those are happening the first three Mondays in March, and then the fourth Monday in March, we'll have a session devoted for a select board candidate. It's an uncontested position this particular year, but select board is super critical job in the town. So in the weekly link, we'll have the link. You can attend Coffee with a Purpose either virtually via Zoom sessions. That's the way Sarah and I usually do it. Or you can attend in person at MetroWorks, right next to Sweetwater's Cafe. Sometimes there's snacks to be shared there if you attend in person. And if you're not available on Monday mornings, as a lot of us aren't, all of the sessions are recorded and available on our YouTube channel as well. So hope to see some of you there, possibly, or hope to you get a chance to watch some of the recordings. Thanks.
Thank you, Doug. As we prepare to light the Christ candle this morning, I invite you to settle your mind, settle your body, settle your spirit, deepening your breath, relaxing your shoulders, even letting your face smile. Once there was someone who said such amazing things and did such wonderful things that people began to follow him. But they didn't know who he was, and so they simply had to ask him. And once he answered, "I am the light that was once in one place at one time, is now in all places and at all times, and it fills the world with shalom. Let us welcome the light."
Good morning, I'm Gail. Please join me in our call to worship. Your response is, come into this house of prayer. And we say those words knowing that the house in question isn't just this sanctuary, but wherever folks are joining us from this morning, work, or the coffee shop, or your very own homes. Leave your to-do lists and worries.
Come in.
Leave your judgments and biases.
Come into this house of prayer.
Leave your loneliness and separation.
Come into this house of prayer.
Your soul needs rest and refuge.
Come into this house of prayer.
Amen. Please stand and rise in body or spirit for our first hymn, which is number 67, God Who Stretched the Spangled Heavens.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Our centering prayer this morning is by John Vandalar and concludes with a version of the Prayer of Jesus by Kate Dalton. We begin with a few moments of silence, a time to think about places in our lives and our world that deeply need the love and the justice of Jesus. Let us pray. Truth be told, Jesus, there are lots of tables that need overturning in our lives. Beneath the veneer of respectability, the tidy rows and neat regulations hide dark addictions and angry judgments, hungry greeds and heartless rejections. We know the pain, and so do those around us, of keeping up the facade. What a relief it would be to have it all upset, smashed, scattered, destroyed. So perhaps, Jesus, today, you could pay us a visit and help us to radically change, radically rearrange the furniture of our lives. We begin by joining together in the words, both ancient and new, as we pray together, saying, O love that is so clear and present in the life of Jesus and his relationship with the oppressed, holy is your manifestation. May your love spread so that we may one day see what creation was created to be. May you sustain us as we work for justice and help us remember that the struggle is long and the costs are often high. May you inspire us to be patient as we encounter resistance and remind us of the holiness of all people. May you help us continue to raise up the voices of the oppressed, despite often strong opposition from the powerful. For you will continue to overcome time again, until one day, no more. Amen. Every Sunday, we turn to each other and share God's peace. This peace is not a superficial getting along, but true shalom, wholeness, well-being, and right relation. There is no peace without justice. There is no peace without justice. There is no justice without peace. Justice and peace exist together, and the search for one leads to the other. The word peace in the Cherokee language is dohai. For centuries, American nations have experienced broken treaties and unfulfilled promises. Too often, there has been enforced peace and an incredible lack of justice. According to a resource from the Presbyterian Today, the Cherokee Nation, a sovereign tribal government, adopted a constitution on September the 6th of 1839, which was 68 years prior to Oklahoma's statehood. It is the largest tribe in the United States, with more than 380,000 tribal citizens located in all 50 states. More than 140,000 reside within the tribe's reservation boundaries in northeastern Oklahoma. The tribe is committed to protecting its people's sovereignty, culture, language, and values. It seeks to improve their quality of life by providing services in health and human services, education, employment, housing, economic and infrastructure development, and environmental protection. God calls us to work for the well-being of all people. It all begins with respect and a determination to repair broken promises and fulfill our national commitment to justice. As we greet each other this morning with peace, Let us not forget the injustices that weigh down our Cherokee siblings. God's peace be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you. Thank you. Oh, we moved this.
Thank you.
Our scripture reading this morning is from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 11, verses 15 through 19. A version of this story appears in all four Gospels. Jesus is in the temple, and something there is making him so angry, he is flipping over the tables. Then Jesus and his disciples came to Jerusalem. And he entered the temple and began to drive out those who were selling and those who were buying in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he would not allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. He was teaching and he was saying, "Is it not written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer for all the nations'? But you have made it a den of robbers." And when the chief priests and the scribes heard it, they kept looking for a way to kill him, for they were afraid of him, because the whole crowd was spellbound by his teaching. And when the evening came, Jesus and his disciples went out of the city. These are our sacred stories. May we have the vision and the wisdom to live them.
Children of all ages are invited to lean in for a word for all ages. We don't need this one, I'm gonna move it out of the way. Have you ever been so mad you could yell? Arrgh! Have you ever been that mad? Have you ever been so mad you wanted to like shake your fist? You ever want to shake your fist at anybody? Yeah, we got some in the back row. Rah. Have you ever been so mad you wanted to flip over all the furniture? Well, that is how mad Janine's like, meh. Janine, it's so hard to picture you being that mad. But that is how mad Jesus got in this morning's scripture reading. He was so mad that he flipped over some of the furniture in the temple. Kind of sounds like the Incredible Hulk, right? Like Jesus hulked out. It's like if I got so mad that I went over to the playground and I just flipped the table right over. Or if Miss Gail went up to the altar table up there and flipped it over. Or Mr. Hank up in the crow's nest just like flipped the whole sound table off the balcony down into the sanctuary. That would be pretty dramatic, wouldn't it? So yeah, let's not do that. This is not one of those what would Jesus do situations. But still, we can understand being mad enough that we want to do something like that. Amen? Like our feelings get so hurt, or something really unfair is happening, or we see people being treated badly. This morning's scripture reading doesn't quite tell us why Jesus got so mad. But we think it has to do with money, mostly because Jesus talked about money all the time. He talked about how loving money can hurt our own lives and other people too. So that day in the synagogue, it might have been that there were people coming to worship and making themselves look good and feel good because they came to worship and they were like saying the prayers and they were given money. So they were feeling pretty good about themselves. But then they would leave worship and they would be mean and unfair. So Jesus wanted to get their attention and tell them that what really matters isn't what happens in worship, but what happens the rest of the time. Whether or not you practice love and compassion and justice when you're out of worship. But you know what? Sometimes it's really hard to remember that. Like in worship, like every other word is about justice and love and compassion. It's not like that when you're out in the world. So sometimes it's hard to remember. Life gets busy. We get stressed. The world tells us to take what we can get, and we forget how God calls us to live. Can I get another amen? Well, we are going to give you a chance to practice this week. Thanks to the outreach team at FCC Natick, we are having a reverse offering. Usually during the offering, we pass the plates up and down the rows, and people put money in the plates to support the ministry of the church. But today, we are going to pass the offering plates and invite everybody to take money out of the plates. The plates are full of envelopes, and each envelope has $5 in it. We are going to give everyone an envelope. It's not one envelope per family. Everybody gets an envelope. And then in the next week or so, we're going to ask everyone to do something with that $5 that will help the world. There are instructions on the envelope and info in the bulletin, but as we talk about this a little bit more, I'm wondering if there are kids who would be willing to help hand out the envelopes. Can I have some kid help down here? And oh, I know, right? And I have kids at heart who are also willing to help if needed, but this is your chance to like be like Oprah and be like, you get $5 and you get $5. You're huge, I'm so sorry. Okay, do I have any more? Yeah, would you like to come hand out? I see you over there, Ryan. You're here, thank you. Look at that, okay, look. You get just a pile of money you get to go hand out to people. Wait, let me take some more. Just go find your way through the sanctuary, make sure everybody, you can just go give people money. Yeah, just go give people money. This is the easiest instruction ever, go give people money. Folks at home, we want you to join in too. You can contact the church office and we'll get you an envelope as long as supplies last, or you can use your own $5. And we want everyone to share how they're gonna use their $5 so we can talk about it in worship on March 17th. My email address is on the envelope, so you can send me a message or drop me a note at the church. But let's brainstorm while the envelopes are being handed out. What are some things we might do? Karen's office has matching funds, so she can donate her $5, and her office will add another $5. That's a great idea. What else can we do with the $5? Some of you were assigned to think about this in advance and have an answer ready. Gail, say it again, Gail. Family Promise. Gail says we could give our $5 to Family Promise and help them give homes to families. What else? Lane? What is, there is a thing called hoops and homework, and you could give your money to that organization. Yeah, go Kirsten. Kirsten said buy something for $5 and sell it for $10. Maybe especially if you bought $5 worth of cookie ingredients, baked cookies, and then sold them for $10. That's the kind of thing you meant, right? Not just jacking up the, okay. Miriam. There is a free medical program in Marlboro that provides medical care, including to folks who are undocumented at no charge, so $5 not only would help get medical care for that person, but would help the people who provide that medical care know that they are not alone in caring about this. Those are great ideas. Kids, do you have any ideas of what you'd want to do with your $5? There is no pressure. Just want to know that it is very important that our kids also get the $5 envelope. They get it too. I cannot wait to see what everyone does with the reverse offering. Thank you for bringing more justice and peace to the world. Those of you who are about to head off to Sunday school and godly play, you might want to hand your envelope to an adult who's with you, but they will give it back to you, and if they don't, you let me know. Let's bless these envelopes and all the possibilities they hold inside. Will you join me in blessing? God of Shalom, fill us with a sense of possibility and abundance, so each $5 bill going out into the world will be a seed of peace, of justice, of transformation. In the same way, God, may each of us be a source of shalom in the world until all as you created it to be. Amen. Have a wonderful day in Sunday school. Our second reading this morning is Fully Lit by Clarissa Pinkola Estes. This is another one of the selections that are in the Soul Sabbatical Guide that we are reflecting on this season. This reading is actually an excerpt from a longer piece called Letter to a Young Activist During Troubled Times. She writes, "Ours is not the task of fixing the entire world all at once, but of stretching out to mend the part of the world that is within our reach. Any small, calm thing that one soul can do to help another soul, to assist some portion of this poor, suffering world, will help immensely. It's not given to us to know which acts, or by whom, will cause the critical mass to tip toward an enduring good. What is needed for dramatic change is an accumulation of acts, adding more, continuing. We know that it does not take everyone on earth to bring justice and peace, but only a small, determined group who will not give up during the first, second, or hundredth gale. One of the most calming and powerful actions you can do to intervene in a stormy world is to stand up and show your soul. Soul on deck shines like gold in dark times. The light of the soul throws sparks, can send up flares, builds signal fires, causes proper matters to catch fire. To display the lantern of soul in shadowy times like these, to be fierce and to show mercy toward others, both are acts of immense bravery and greatest necessity. Struggling souls catch light from other souls who are fully lit and are willing to show it. If you would help to calm the tumult, this is one of the strongest things you can do. Amen." So Jesus is like some kind of aggressive secret shopper. This is what I kept thinking of reflecting on this week's scripture. Churches do this just like stores do. They recruit someone to come visit on a Sunday morning to provide feedback on what it's like to be a guest. How's the signage? Can you figure out what door to enter and where the elevator is? Are you welcomed warmly without being pressured to join a committee? What do you learn about the congregation's values? Is the priority the numbers in the pews or the spreadsheet, the spiritual grounding of those gathered, the preservation of a building, the congregation's impact on the world, the articulated conviction of faith? Does the liturgy make you feel like an outsider with everyone else knowing what to do while you're left to guess? Can you tell what year it is just by listening to the sermon and the music? Throughout my years in ministry, I have been too afraid to arrange for a secret shopper, opting for blissful ignorance rather than facing a report that highlights my faults. Oh my gosh, I just realized my CPE supervisor is over there and he might have something to say about that. We can talk about it later. He did the same thing, yes! But Jesus didn't even wait to submit the report. He saw things he didn't like at the temple and he provided immediate feedback, rather tantrum-y kind of feedback, honestly. And there were severe consequences for that feedback. According to Mark's gospel, this is the episode that leads to Jesus' death. This passage of scripture is rich and complicated. There is a great deal of debate about why Jesus flipped over the tables and why the consequences were so severe. But I'm going to save an examination of the text for another time. Instead, this morning, can we just agree Jesus got really mad about something, he turned over tables in the temple, and it got him in trouble. Okay. Which could make this a weird scripture passage for talking about shalom, right? Shalom is most often thought about as peace, and Jesus sure as heck wasn't bringing peace to the temple that day. Nobody feels peaceful when furniture's flying and doves are flapping and money is bouncing everywhere. In that moment, Jesus was, if anything, a disturber of the peace. If peace is everything being calm and quiet, organized and orderly. Jesus was the opposite of that, and on more than one occasion. Jesus, as a Jewish prophet, was focused on justice, and he was not afraid to make noise for justice, even if it disrupted the peace. It was a core part of his mission, to call people to repentance, to turning back toward God, to building the beloved community where the world is as God created it to be. As such, Jesus believed that practicing justice would bring peace, but he wasn't willing to sacrifice justice for some superficial peace facade. We've seen this tension between peace and justice again and again. A dictatorship can look very peaceful, but that's only because of the rule of fear. Martin Luther King Jr. was chastised by clergy for prioritizing justice for all people and holding disruptive marches rather than docile Bible studies. Women, queer people, and Black, Indigenous people of color have been told again and again to stop being loud, disruptive, and angry, that if they would just be patient, justice would arrive. Someday. Maybe without justice, you can have something that looks like peace, but it isn't shalom. It isn't the peace of flourishing, well-being, and wholeness. In worship this Lent, we are displaying banners that are part of the Palm Sunday procession at FCC Natick. Each banner connects in some way to the theme in the Way of Shalom guide that Sarah Lynn created. This week's banner declares Lord. Lord, right? Yes, great, okay. Lord is, of course, one of the terms used for Jesus and for God. In Greek, it is Kyrie, and the word means master, owner, the one to whom something belongs. In Jesus' time, it would have also been the title for the Roman emperor. Every time Jesus was called Lord, he threatened the powerful and violent empire. But Jesus didn't shy away from that label, or other things that made him a target for the empire, like turning over the tables in the temple. In contemporary parlance, we could even say that he leaned into it, never missing an opportunity to challenge the economic and political system that was controlling, oppressing, and robbing the people. After all, that era was called the Pax Romana, Roman peace, not Justitia Romana, Roman justice. The empire might have looked peaceful, but it was not just. Jesus as Lord pointed to a different kind of empire, one with both justice and peace. The title pointed to the kingdom of God, the way creation was meant to be. So in our scripture reading this morning, it describes the time that Jesus literally turned over the tables, but really his whole ministry was one of table turning. Again and again, like any good Jewish prophet, Jesus turned over the tables of political abuse, economic injustice, bias and exclusion, religious judgment. Jesus turned over the tables where the trappings of empire were displayed, fear and oppression and division. Jesus turned over the tables where not everyone was given a seat, where there was only room for the powerful and mighty. Jesus turned over the tables to spread the feast to those who usually only got the crumbs. Jesus turned over the tables to find out who was caught and imprisoned underneath, trapped by the empire in all its forms. Jesus turned over the tables in pursuit of shalom. And it cost him his life. Not that his death was the end of the story, but that's a sermon for next month. Here's the thing. Over 2,000 years later, there are still so many tables. Thank you. Maybe more than ever before. Tables of empire, displaying a spread of injustice and trapping the vulnerable beneath. Because now, it's up to us to flip them over. It's up to us to flip over the table that has made safe and affordable housing a mere fantasy for so many. It's up to us to flip over the table that treats people seeking asylum in our country like they are committing a crime. It's up to us to flip over the table that tells us to hide our truths, our addictions, and anxiety and abuse. It's up to us to flip over the table that would rather send black boys to prison than to college, feeding the voracious prison industry. It's up to us to flip over the table that sacrifices the lives of trans youth, creating hostile environments in their own schools. It's up to us to flip over the table that systematically compounds wealth even as it compounds poverty. It is up to us to flip over those tables, but not on our own. Scripture says that's what Jesus did. He flipped over the tables by himself while everybody watched and rapped. But flipping over a table is much easier if you have someone to help. And that's part of what a community of faith is about. People working together to overturn empires' tables of injustice. You take one side, I take the other, the kids help in the middle, and the tables that looked like they were permanent fixtures finally turn. Then we can use those tables to build something new. A home with room for all, a dance floor for celebrating, a bridge across understanding. So how do we start? Well, you got $5 in your pocket, so that's a beginning. A dream written on a strip of fabric and added to the prayer tree is another great step. Next weekend, there are not one, but two gatherings where people will be turning over tables left and right. See the info in your bulletin and join in. And actually, there are at least five other opportunities in this Sunday's bulletin alone to start shaking the tables of empire. So let's create it together. The kingdom of God, the beloved community, the way to shalom. Amen. As a faith community, we know the power of connecting our hearts to God's presence. So during this time, we share our joys and concerns in prayer. Folks in the room, you'll be invited to share yours loud, and anyone is invited to send in prayers to prayers@fccnatick.org. And we hold in prayer everyone on the prayer list in the bulletin. A reminder that you might also want to get a strip of fabric now to write a prayer on if you haven't already done so. We begin with our joys. What joys do you bring to this place today? And I just want to say I have at least three concerns, so I need at least two joys. Marsha. She's what? No way. Marsha's daughter turns 44 today. Happy birthday to your daughter. Marsha, are you able to share, are you comfortable sharing your daughter's name? Amy. We pray for Amy, who has dealt with miscarriages in her life. This past week, went through IVF treatment, and so is in that place of prayer and anticipation and stress and worry, but also watching the news, and she lives in Texas. So may we hold Amy in extra prayer in this time, as well as those who love her and who are caring for her from afar. May this birthday be one that is full of joy for Amy. Thanks, Marsha. Other joys, Jeanette. It is so wonderful to have Kirsten, Jenna, and Jeff back from Guatemala, and next week we'll hear a little bit more about their trip. Thanks, Kirsten. Yeah, Pam. Will you be able to go? Okay. We'll stick with the joy. So Pam's godson, Julius, is preparing to marry his beloved Annabelle. We celebrate that. Yeah. Lane, do you have any joys up there?
You hear me? Yeah. Just one from last week that I forgot to share. My nephew and his wife surprised us last Saturday and came and visited us from Aww. Virginia. Surprise.
What's your nephew's name, Lane?
Reed. Reed and Mackenzie came.
We are so glad that Reed and Mackenzie surprised Lane last week and visited. Those times are precious. What concerns do you bring to this place today? Lorraine. Prayers for Charles and Barbara. No, wait, he's your stepbrother? Your stepbrother. He's Lorraine's stepbrother, but he is, that's just a definition. He's very close to Lorraine's heart, and cancer has returned, and he's on hospice. So prayers for him, for his family, and for Lorraine as she faces grief. Thanks, Lorraine. Sarah Beth. We hold in our prayers Sarah Beth's mother, who had a fall. She's 84. She did okay. She was bruised. She's got a compression fracture, but, you know, it's just going to take time to healing. But she's also dealing with changes she has to make because of that, where she lives, having to remove rugs, and she's not very happy about it. So prayers for Sarah Beth's mom for healing, and also for Sarah Beth's brother, who's there taking care of her. Marcia. Marcia is lifting up our siblings in Gaza who have dealt with incredible loss of life, but also loss of home and well-being. And even though we do not understand maybe the way to shalom there, we certainly hold our siblings in prayer. Thanks, Marcia. Lane, do you have any?
Gretchen, do you have that one? Her Gretchen, her Aunt Mary passed away this Thursday morning, and she asked for send prayers to her and her family so they can find peace and comfort during this time of loss.
Gretchen's Aunt Mary passed away, so we're holding the extended family in prayer during this time of loss. Thanks, Lane. We're holding Joel in our prayers. This is David's brother, Janet's brother-in-law. He burned his arm this past week badly enough that he's in the Mass General burn unit, so prayers for healing and comfort for him. We're holding in our prayers Doug and Bea. They are leaders with SOAR Natick, which is the Supporting Outreach and Addiction Recovery Group. Doug has had a heart attack. He's in the hospital. I don't know if we have any updates on that. They are struggling with the fact that Doug is going to die, and they are preparing to donate his organs. You folks may know that their son, Jeff, died 3 years ago this month, so from overdose. So holding B and the rest of the family in our prayers. We also hold in our prayers the family of Nex Benedict. This is the non-binary Oklahoma teen who died after a fight at school. The cause of death is still under investigation, but what is clear is that the last year of their life was impacted by bullying and their state government making laws that negatively impacted them. So we hold Nex's family in our prayers. Did I miss anything? Our pastoral prayer this morning comes from a writer I just learned about this week, Avery Arden. I'm grateful for the way they share their writing. Let us be together in prayer. Living God, who helps us discern when to hold fast and when to let go, which tables to fix and which ones to flip. Hear our prayers for those who engage in the long and thankless labor of stripping tables of their unjust trappings, who drag folding chairs into the rooms where decisions get made and refuse to shut up until every voice is heard. Hear our prayers of gratitude for those courageous ones who recognize that some tables are beyond refurbishing, who refuse to cover up rotten foundations with surface fixes. Hear our prayers for comfort for those who struggle with anger, anxiety, or trauma, who lash out at the wrong targets, who sabotage themselves and their relationships, or else who keep their anger bottled up, too tangled up in niceness and respectability to make their hurts known and set boundaries. Hear our prayers of solidarity with those whose trauma stems from Christianity, for churches claiming to act in God's name, for all whose dignity has been denied and gifts rejected. And hear our prayers for those who fight the good fight to put an end to such injustices in our midst through education, reparations, and collaboration. O God with us, you who dwell in the midst of our struggling, for these things and for all the wordless yearnings of our hearts, we pray. Amen. At FCC Natick take stewardship seriously, including the stewardship of your financial contributions. They are always trying to figure out how to save money, being efficient and cost conscious, except when they're not. Except when they're trying to address something even more important than saving money, like saving the planet. FCC is enrolled in 100% green through the Natick Electricity Aggregation Program, which means that 100% of our electricity comes through renewable energy. According to the utilities wizard Wayne, that costs us an additional $690 per year. In addition, In addition, when we renovated the kitchen, we replaced gas appliances with electric appliances as part of a commitment to move away from fossil fuels whenever possible. We're not quite sure what the impact will be on utility costs, but we expect there will be an increase. This is what justice looks like in a church budget. Being at least as responsible to the impacts of climate change, especially on the poor and marginalized, as we are to the budget's bottom line. You make this possible through your generosity and your commitment. As we participate in the spiritual discipline of the morning offering, let's celebrate the electricity that lights this room and powers our streaming on Pegasus knowing that this is just one way we turn the tables. God of abundance, bless these gifts and especially the ways in which they will bring your justice to the world. Amen. Thank you. So our closing hymn is Lift Every Voice. That's what we're doing now, right? You all just sat down, but it made me super nervous. Okay. Our closing hymn is Lift. I mean, you are welcome to sit down, whatever. Right. But nonetheless, our closing hymn, you won't want to sit down through it. It's Lift Every Voice and Sing, which is often referred to as the Black National Anthem. Representative Matt Gaetz decided he couldn't watch this year's Super Bowl because this song was going to be sung along with the national anthem. Here is how Reverend Dr. Yvonne Delk from the UCC describes the hymn. The words written by James Weldon Johnson in 1900 were a mandate that would center and anchor a people living and existing in a system designed to dehumanize and deny their essential worth and value as persons. The words were a call to hold on and hold out in the context of the day-to-day reign of terror experienced in lynchings, Jim Crow laws, and a legal system of separation designed to deny them their full humanity and to keep them enslaved and oppressed. The ability to survive and persevere, as well as the courage to resist oppression, would be centered in the call to stay true to our God and true to our native land. We sing it this morning as an anthem of shalom.
Thank you.
Beloved, may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may God give you peace in your going out and your coming in your lying down and in your rising up, in your labor and in your leisure, in your laughter and in your tears, until you come to stand before God in that day in which there is no sunset and no dawning. Go in peace. Amen.